All set, roll. About a month or two ago, thinking, you know, is it what is this? Is it just a kind of an ego thing to get all these people in, and you know, a bit of a wank? And then I think it might have been Liam or somebody said, why wouldn't you? If you could, why wouldn't you do something like this? And I thought, yeah, that's a good enough answer. You don't have to justify it. You know, if you can get some musicians that you really admire and you know they're good people and their families are cool as well, why wouldn't you get them out for a Christmas holiday and hang out and have some fun?
That's good, guys.
It's working.
Could you run this desk if you had to?
Hey?
Could you run this if you had to?
No.
I've never recorded an album in 3 weeks. Deadlines are the musician's best friend. I was inspired to get the Seven Worlds rolling again by the fact that whenever I would talk to one of the original people, Johnny or Ed, there was always this kind of whisper that we should do it again sometime. And earlier in the year, I saw just about everybody at one point or another and said, well, when? You know, when would be a good time? And Christmas started to sound good for various people in the Northern Hemisphere, the idea of a South Pacific sojourn and bringing the families maybe this time, and we wanted to make it different. So a recording project was appealing. Because I had this beautiful space now that we've built, and I'm so delighted with it that I want to sort of fill it up with music and friends. Make a happening.
He kind of put a shout out about a year ago to say, okay, if this is going to happen, kind of try and keep your diary, you know, empty next year.
Johnny had been sort of speaking to Neil, and there was a vibe that something was coming around. It was 7 years since the last venture.
Because we've been trying to get him to do a reunion. At least I have. Like, once a year I'll say, see, everybody's different now. We should do it again. So then the summer he goes, no, I have an idea. I think we're going to do it. How does it sound to spend Christmas and New Year's in Piha and write a record?
Looking at porn on the computer. That'll help.
I have no idea how it's going to work. I'm trusting that good people, when they get in a room together with a will to do something good, will create the plan. I have only made a plan up to a point.
Actually, the first time I heard about Seven Worlds colliding, I was actually quite taken aback, you know, horrified. And then later it was brought to my attention that it was a music sort of thing. So I thought, well, I ought to be involved. Neil doesn't know anything about roll calls, agendas, items, you know, what sort of folder to have. Do you use a pencil or a pen? Do you have a rubber on the end of it? That's where I would come in, Neil. I was travelling from the States, coming back here to New Zealand, and there's only one flight annually, I think, so I was lucky to get on it, and Wilco were there, gave me their tapes and a DVD and a couple of posters, and then kept coming up to me four or five times during the flight. It's us again, Wilco. Yeah, all right, okay. Yeah, I haven't got time now to look at your stuff, but you know, I'm very busy.
Our family all love Wilco. It's something that we all agree on. So I just shot off a wishful email to them, and got an immediate response from them, really. The idea just sort of tickled their fancy?
Instantly, it was yes. I mean, the project alone, but just that he, you know, thought to invite everyone's families.
You know, there's something exciting about going to make a record somewhere. And I can't think of a better place or a better time than January in New Zealand.
We're very lucky to have at the helm a very experienced and lovely gentleman called Jim Scott, who's done so many good projects I couldn't begin to tell you. And is you know, old school in the sense that he started mixing live bands and he's just an enthusiast.
Jim!
He's just, yeah, salt of the earth. So I'm expecting he's gonna be sitting in that room in there and, you know, running a pretty lean operation, I think, but enjoying himself, hopefully.
Jim Scott's fantastic. Again, you know, the right person, really professional. He really fits in because everyone's slightly unusual, I think.
So Neil Finn, did you know much about him before this whole thing?
I kind of knew what everyone else knew, that Crowded House should have been the biggest band in the world. Even though they were successful, they should have been the benchmark. Just the songwriting and the singing and just the quality of the music was... That's what I knew about Crowded House.
Yeah, and just, he is a great singer. I love his voice, and I love his songwriting. I mean, that's all I want to do, is record people that have talent. It's really all I want to do.
I was a Split Enz fan. I was in a band, and we covered I Got You and History Never Repeats. Yeah.
I've been listening to songs that he's written or played on since I was in high school.
Neil is the only person I would be doing this with, you know, because I really am kind of trying to find something else to do, and then when he asked me to do this, I'm like, oh, well, I have to. There's no choice.
Neil's had a long and very positive relationship with Oxfam, so I've known him for a couple of years now. He's been extremely supportive of our work across the board. Oxfam is a confederation of 13 organizations around the world working to overcome poverty and injustice. We operate in over 100 countries, working directly with communities to empower people and provide a safer environment and help them achieve their basic rights.
So they came to see me earlier in the year and said, would you be interested at any point in doing a record on our behalf? And I was just at the time discussing with the Seven Worlders the concept of coming out again, and it seemed to be a bit of synchronicity in it. So I said, yeah, funny you should mention it.
We're inside Roundhead Studios in Auckland. This is where this mighty musical collective will be locked up for the next 3 weeks or so, rehearsing for their three shows and concocting a studio album of brand new music.
I was just imagining, like, two drummers, two bass players, four or five guitars, everybody plays the piano, everybody sings. My only question was to Neil was, like, are the songs written? Or are we getting together to, like, write the songs and then work? I mean, you gotta have the songs together. And he said, oh, no, everyone's coming. Everyone's coming with songs. Yeah. Yeah. They were coming with them. They just hadn't been written yet.
Yeah, I see you in New Zealand then. 6 weeks time and bring a couple of songs. That was kind of what he said, but...
I was told that if I didn't bring a complete song that would potentially be a single, I wouldn't be welcome.
Well, no, everybody was told to sort of bring, you know, if they had a song, that would be ideal.
I didn't realize that he wanted me to write a song. I thought everybody was going to write together.
We realized that everyone's a massive neurosis to start off with, and then you'd push on through and find lurking within you great musicality and a generous spirit, you know, real fierce attachment to music and what it can do for us. Everybody's very similar in that respect.
The first night jam was a systems check for the crew and I just needed to hear sounds. I needed to see how picky everyone would be about their sound and their headphone and whether or not
they would be willing to just try this big experiment and lose their, you know, lose their own identity inside of this big giant mess.
Oh yeah, yeah.
So there is some, yeah.
That's right.
How are you? Now that's a good sight.
Morning.
Morning. Did you sleep well?
Did I?
Yeah, missing out the sea the first time, second time the hint of the riff of that final, the outro riff.
Is that what you're talking about?
No, I was playing the way you get into
it. Oh, no, well, yeah, we should do that anyway.
Yeah, okay, cool.
I'll just sing the second half of the phrase on G. I did a half pattern on the G.
So when we hit the G...
Oh, the G, I think, it doesn't matter how we hit it, I suppose. The G, we hit the G.
Actually build some intensity into that G as well.
Hey, Neil, is it the G before the F?
Third time we hang on the G. And then I'll maybe call it...
Who's next?
Hello, Auckland! I really like Auckland, and I like it more now. I'll tell you why. Because tomorrow at 1 p.m. at your Natural History Museum, there is a free great white shark autopsy. We don't have that. That's really cool.
Katie Tunstall was suggested by Glenn, who had shared a few festival bills and ended up talking and found out she was going to be in New Zealand on honeymoon with her very good drummer boyfriend.
When Neil told me she was involved, I said to him, you know, we'd met so long ago and she's seriously one of the nicest people I've ever met anywhere. And she's one of those really cool girls that's probably really used to being one of the boys and being in bands and being on the road, so she's really easy to be with.
Big Ranga! I love her. I'm so glad she's here. I met Bic 7 years ago. I was a guest vocalist for a Jewish hip-hop band. Bic was on tour with us in Europe as the support. And she was pretty quiet, kept herself to herself, always looked amazing. It's just great to sort of meet each other at quite a different place in life. We're gonna call ourselves the Chingalings. We're both Chinese heritage. Her, obviously, more than me, but I'm quarter Chinese. So that was nice, too.
For some reason, we just really vibed off each other, and Katie had a little snippet of a song, about a woman who was wearing a black silk ribbon around her throat. And I just said, why don't we get her to kill someone? And it was sort of just, it was very cathartic.
Vic and I sat in the basement and decided to write a murder ballad about killing a man. It was her idea, actually.
It was like going to a spa. I'd just like to point out that over there is Katie's husband. And his name's Luke. They're on their honeymoon.
Then she's like, well, fuck it then.
Who the hounds eat him?
And we could even have the hounds be eaten.
Just when
you're so twisted.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
Basically did most of the organising, from baby seats and cots to dietary requirements, and yeah, it was pretty huge.
So is this the one who does all the work?
This is Julia, who is the backbone of this whole project.
It's not, she's gone. She's in a mental institution.
It hasn't been hard at all. Just a bit of organisation.
We were hoping it would be like a real family occasion, you know, everyone, all inclusive.
And the kids are running around, and it's a really lovely feeling that this community of people is relaxed enough to mean that any kid could walk in the door at any point of any session and would be fine.
Studios can tend to be quite exclusive affairs, but this has been, everyone's included, and my two little ones have been welcomed into the studio with open arms, and they've loved it. In fact, they'd much rather hang out in the studio than they would on the beach.
Let your hair.
Let your hair?
That's half.
Yeah, the other half's
done. The half. Oh, mate, the tank, we're not blowing it. My tank only lasted 5 seconds. It just got blown.
Give me Patrick has actually started picking up a little bit of a Kiwi accent. We reckon maybe he was here for another week.
Are you speaking
Kiwi?
We can take
a proper Kiwi boy back home with us. He's nearly there with yes.
Oh my God! The eyes are
It's uncanny.
Of course it's uncanny.
Having the family has been really particularly great for me because I've been so busy the last few years, and the period leading up to coming out here, I've been away quite a lot.
She's on the phone and painting, which is quite good.
I'm painting a banana.
Who knows, I might actually paint a banana pattern. Tricky, though.
This way I get to work and the family are involved in that world too, and they're all really involved. You know, Angie and you know, my wife and my kids are really close with Neil and Sharon and Elroy and Liam, and you know, we're like a kind of extended family, really.
That's awesome, Sammy. Keep the mouth like that, definitely. However many eyes you think you have.
A beard. Oh, God. It's fine. First it's a unibrow, then it's a penis nose.
That's just got a black eye. What are you trying to say? Spencer's self-portrait is a cry for help.
Oh, yeah.
Tibetan Blues was written one of the first few days with Ed O'Brien. He'd learnt this Tibetan mantra that he really loved, and he put it to the simple, you know, three chord blues pattern, and we came up with just a couple of different sections for it, and then took it into the writing room and got Elroy and Johnny played some bass, and then Dad came in and we just sort of worked up the song.
Let's just play it through a few times so we kind of get into the habit of getting between the parts. And
three, four.
Tibetan Blues was another example of me being in the right place at the right time, so I got to jump on any kind of insecurities that I had before about being in a room with Johnny were kind of eliminated, seeing him in a bed. Ed's always been a fantastic singer in Radiohead, doing all the, you know, epic backing vocals. That mantra really seems to suit his voice, and he's such a tall, handsome man, and going, oh, is quite a fitting thing, I think. I haven't, as such, written songs with Dad yet. I think that's definitely something on the cards. I think the family band idea is looming. It seems like a glamorous idea, but I don't know even if it would work. Could work.
Big Ronda, everybody!
Neil was pretty casual about the way he brought it up. He just sort of said, oh, you know, I'm gonna do this thing. Didn't really feel like anything when he was saying it, but now that we're all here, it's like, oh my God, this is so amazing. I had a country waltz which I brought to the Wilco guys, and I'm a big fan of theirs, so you know, it was perfect. That was a song called A Change of Heart. Sort of feel like a total phony writing a country waltz, but those Wilco guys, it's really their territory, and they have all those little nuances that, I don't know, you can't really teach someone. That's just, I guess it's in their blood to play that way.
Can't we go back to the start? You can't deny the change of heart.
Do you think the drums need to just keep going, maybe?
I think the bass and the drums should keep going, right? Okay. Try it again?
Well, I was going to say maybe even wait.
Wait the whole 8, yeah.
No, wait, because she sings, can't we go back to the start, maybe, oh, right on start.
Little word painting there. Oh, see what I'm doing
there?
That's big picture stuff.
It's classy.
Classy.
Stay fun.
I think the one thing I'd pinch from the studio is Jeff's 12-string Telecaster. Just because I'm from Manchester, you know. I can do that.
Seriously, my 12 string is missing. It's gone. If I don't find my 12 string, I'm gonna fucking lose it!
Piha was a great environment, and we knew that they would love it.
It was beautiful and pretty idyllic. And for someone like myself who likes to get out and hit the trails and go tramping, as they say here, I was in heaven.
Piha's great. Nice being back. It's the third time I've been there, and really pretty special place.
We'd gone down to the Gap earlier to watch the waves, and it was the most frightening, brilliant, dazzling display of water I've ever seen. It was just looking at it going, that would kill me. Wow. And the waves change all the time, and the lifeguards are all over. I mean, it's quite exciting. And then the whale placenta this morning was pretty weird.
It was a nice place until whale fetuses started washing up on the beach.
See this? It's basically, it's like 100 of those.
I understood what people had been saying to me about the fact that West Coasters are a bit mental.
It's a fantastic place. It's been a very super creative thing. You know, as I say, I wrote a couple of songs here, actually, that I think Piha kind of brought that out, really.
Johnny's got a song for you. It's a new one. You wrote it at Piha.
Well, it's in Piha on Christmas Eve. Hope I can remember it. Really.
Johnny wanted to work on a song with a couple of people, and so I kind of managed to slide in there and claim a place on the drum set.
Yeah.
I think because of a scenario where there's a load of musicians, you know, we can have two drummers, we can have two bass players, just thought, well, if I was ever going to do a sort of Phil Spector kind of number, this is the time to do it. So I wrote this song, Two Blue. I wrote the music, and then Jeff Tweedy wrote the lyrics with me, and then we cut it as like a big band.
Is kind of a thing I haven't done very much before, and I found it was quite challenging, but just kind of hope it all gels at the end of it and feels right.
That's the difference between a Mancunian and someone from Oxford, the humble Oxford peasant.
Yeah.
Versus the noble Mancunian
warrior, big mouth.
Seriously, guys, have you seen my 12 string?
It was over there with the other 12 string.
There's plenty of 12 strings, so I mean, take your pick. Mar, right? Is he here? He's gone.
Safe to say that the standard of talent all around was pretty amazing.
Who's the best engineer, Jeff?
I think you all have your good points. I spent the most time with Jordan. He's constantly surprised and encouraged by his confidence behind the keyboard. When I ventured upstairs, Simon did an excellent job. And Neil, obviously, runs the whole show. Seriously, everything sounded great. Everywhere I went, you guys all did an amazing job. All right, bye.
Good evening. Welcome to Seven Worlds Collide.
Also, big thanks to Neil and Sharon Finn for opening up their house to all these dodgy rock geezers for these last few weeks.
The night before, I was still working on my first song, which is called Long Time Gone. I was still mucking around with it in that first day, but I wasn't in the dog ate my homework mode.
It was morning in Brighton, but the fire in the bar didn't give off any heat. The sun crept in unnoticed and tried to find itself a seat. I was explaining and complaining, I had lined up all the facts. You could see where this was heading, you stopped me in my tracks.
I think what happens is when you're really immersed in a musical project, the distinctions between people drop away, and you're just talking about what idea is a good idea. That's a good idea, that's a good song, this will make that song better. Rather than, you know, those kind of don't you know who I think I am moments, which come thick and fast in rock and roll.
Have you got that camera on?
Mm.
Okay, the cucumber is literally the black hole of foodstuffs. Exhibit A. Exhibit B, exhibit C. No self-respecting 80s icon. We'll be dealing with that. Would Simon Le Bon be having that? No. No. Would Michael Stipe put up with it? No. Would Tom York put up with it? No. I know, it's because I play guitar, it's because I'm from Manchester, isn't it?
I'm carrying away cucumber gift to Johnny. For my best friend, Johnny, love, Jeff. XOXO. Everybody get that?
Yeah, I got it. Yeah.
Situation, honey.
I've noticed.
Okay. is this what you're like in Radiohead?
What?
He comes in and dominates the entire situation. I was trying to do an interview, right?
It's always me, Selway.
How I wrote OK Computer.
Yeah.
Mr.
Creep.
Again.
That was him.
Again, Creep, yeah.
Yeah, the big guitar steps, that was his idea.
Yeah, why? Why? Because he forgot to come in on the drums. We have to take all night, Phil, don't worry. We have to be here all night.
It takes all night.
Always has to be about Phil.
Me. You notice that first night I've got a song, I'll sing it on the stairs so everyone passing will know how good it is.
Don't need for that, Phil.
Now, I guess if there's one person who I'd single out really would be Phil. Now, he came essentially as a drummer, and people expected him to be a drummer, and he came here and he wrote two beautiful songs from the heart.
I think I crashed the songwriting process myself.
That comes out of this place, it's relaxed, it's joyous, but there's also a dark undercurrent. And what I've liked about the music that's come out is that there is a darkness there. And like New Zealand, there's a heart of darkness to this place. And I think this is key. New Zealand is key, and Neil is key.
Dad had a wild pass at putting a vocal on, and then I did a wild pass, and then Jeff did a wild pass, and I think Pat might have done one as well, and then we ended up just all sitting in the room, turning it up really loud and unmuting everything, and strangely it all seemed to fit. And I definitely went into it knowing in my head what Dad would probably have naturally sung, and I really wanted to try and do something a bit more shoutier, a bit more intense, and a bit, I don't know, get some youth in there. It sort of became a father and son verse and chorus.
It's just been amazing to see this thing, you know, that I've been kicking around for a couple of years, just not really knowing what to do with it, and it's a proper band song, which is great.
Time I thought, you stole my guitar, we'll meet again. And I will beat you with a cucumber. Bye. For now.
In some ways, my own work has lagged behind the pace of the project because I'm making sure I'm enjoying everybody else's contributions. I don't want to miss much.
I have very sort of fond memories of being away the last couple of years and calling home. Mum and Dad would be sounding quite jolly on the phone, and they'd just been jamming all night, and it was very, I don't know, romantic thought to think of my parents having a glass of wine and a jam. I'm a walking machine.
Neil and Sharon have written two possible contenders. I think those are like hit songs.
So I knew that they'd been playing together, but I didn't know that they had these, you know, really great pop songs, and little by little really surprised me.
Oh, that was an interesting experience. I want this the first for us to do one of ours. On this occasion, I think you all that talent, that's for sure, but everyone was really supportive. And Jim, who was, you know, master and commander of Studio A, is really a great presence to build up your confidence. And, you know, there was just a plethora of amazing musicians around to see who wanted to enter the frame. Shed when they left, one by one. It was sort of, you know, drawn out. But Sue, Tweedy and the boys left first, and that was quite traumatic, actually.
It's too sad.
She just sick.
It's amazing you get attached so quickly.
If I could go back.
See you guys.
Power. I can choose. Oh, what could have been.
I am not looking forward to going home in the slightest.
I'm about to give Johnny his going away present.
Okay.
I was told that you usually like a parting gift.
I do, yeah.
Sorry, that's you. To my best friend.
That's beautiful, Jeff.
The whole thing's been an amazing journey. Yeah, just all those creative minds and amazing people all together was just one building of amazing creative energy.
When the record does come out, absolutely, we're crossing our fingers and hoping that people love it and that they buy it, because the proceeds will be directly benefiting the work that we do.
Giving away the publishing, all of that, any profits that are made go to Oxfam. Again, it's good stuff for the whole project.
I think it was a really great idea of Neil's to actually make that the focus of the whole project. It means everybody's coming in with the right spirit.
This experience for Neil has been intense but incredibly enjoyable. To have all his friends and new friends come and enjoy you know, the environment we've created here is great for him.
I would definitely rate this as the most intense thing I've ever been part of. It was just truly mind-blowing, and I can't imagine, you know, having a better musical experience than this other than trying to do another one.
It's been pretty amazing and exceeded my expectations, which were pretty high to begin with.
I've been in New Zealand now for almost a month, and I keep delaying my flight. It's been amazing.
I think so much of it is to do with Neil and Sharon, though. Any project is a reflection of who's decided to set it up. And it's really obvious that they completely rule.
You know, testament to the whole thing and to all the people involved and to Neil is the generosity again, the spirit of it, welcoming people in, you know, come on, come and try something.
Same as the last time, the last time was, it's just like a, you know, just a nice fest, you know, full-on
love
in.
There is a lot of love in the buildings, a lot of love on the road between Pihar and Auckland. We're pumped up with love, yeah.
It has really been a special, beautiful, unbelievable time. It's monumental.
Probably one of, you know, the most extraordinary musical experiences of my life, really. If not the most.